بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه الطاهرين، وبعد. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. By the grace and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have entered into stage 3 of the lockdown, and society has to a large degree returned back to normal. However, there are certain norms that we shouldn't return to. One such norm, a South African norm, a pre-COVID-19 lockdown norm, was that we were ranked 6th in terms of the world's drunkest countries ranking. So of the top 10 countries, we are ranked number 6. The World Health Organization informs us that 3 million people annually die as a direct result of alcohol abuse. Many studies, multifaceted studies, have proven that there's a definite link between alcohol abuse on the one side and domestic violence on the other side. Another stat is that the World Health Organization says that 5% of the disease burden is directly linked to alcohol. So we've seen that in stage 3, the ban on alcohol sales have been lifted. What are our thoughts regarding that particular ban? And during the lockdown, we were afforded the opportunity to experience what an alcohol-free South Africa would look like. Obviously, the lockdown has been lifted, and for the said benefits, what are the benefits? Perhaps if we look from a SARS perspective, that during the lockdown, that revenue was lost. The alcohol revenue was lost. Now with the ban lifted, they are once again receiving that particular revenue. Is that a benefit? From that particular perspective, you could very well look at it as a benefit. What I want to look at is from the Quranic perspective. If you look at this phenomenon from a Quranic perspective, we find that يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ, that the companions, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, and they had a number of questions that they addressed to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of the questions was, they ask you about wine and they ask you about gambling. قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ. The response, and these are the formative verses revealed in relation to alcohol. فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ. In it there's a great sin, and at the same time there are benefits. So Quran acknowledges that there are benefits to alcohol. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is quick to follow that up by saying, وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِنْ نَفْعِهِمَا. However, that the sin is greater than the benefits. And in terms of our modern terminology, our modern nomenclature, in terms of the way that we phrase things, you could say that from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's perspective, that the cons of wine are much greater than the pros. So we would acknowledge that there are pros to alcohol, but by far the cons outweigh the cons outweigh the pros, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. There's another argument, and that argument is that should we ban alcohol completely, in other words, we have a complete alcohol-free South Africa, what would that result in? That would result in the following, that alcohol sales or the alcohol industry would simply go underground, and the whole purpose would be defeated. There's another example that is cited in this particular regard, and it's a true stat in as far as we know, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. There was a time in America where alcohol was legally banned. It was completely banned. And in order to enforce this particular ban, the government at the time had spent trillions of dollars in order to enforce this particular ban. It didn't work, and the ban was lifted. The reason why I'm mentioning that is because if we take that stat that we have in front of us, that empirical evidence that we have in front of us, and we juxtapose it to the Quranic example, what happened in the Quranic example? In the Quranic example, it didn't cost a single dollar. It didn't cost a single silver coin, nor a single gold coin. It basically took 3 verses, literally 3 verses. The first verse was the verse I quoted to you a few moments ago, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they ask you about wine, say to them that it has benefits and it has harms, but the harms far outweigh the benefits. That was the first verse. The second verse relates to, whilst the consumption of alcohol was still permissible within an Islamic paradigm in the early days of Islam, When you come to prayer, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la taqrabu as-salah. Don't come to the place of prayer wa antum sukara whilst you are intoxicated, whilst you are under the influence of alcohol. That was the second verse. The third verse, the categorical verse, which outlaws, makes alcohol consumption illegal within an Islamic paradigm, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Innamal khamru wal maysiru wal ansab wal azlamu rijsu min amri shaitan fajtanibu. These are the acts of the devil, fajtanibu, steer clear of it. It was literally these three verses that were effective in terms of creating an alcohol-free society. So it might appear to be very, very simplistic, but if we were to look at the Quranic approach, we find there are many narrations where certain of the companions who said that if this prohibition was revealed in Makkah, in other words, in the early days of Islam, it would have been very difficult, now impossible for Muslims to comply. And therefore it was revealed in Medina. But when it was revealed in Medina, then all the believers complied to such a degree that the narration says that the streets of Medina flowed in alcohol. Why was that? It is because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he worked on their hearts. And from an Islamic paradigm, the heart basically is the locus for the mind. So in other words, he worked on their hearts and he worked on their minds. And once we work on the hearts and we reform the hearts and we reform the mind, and then we are able to legislate that which is ultimately in the benefit of the laws for whom it is being legislated. And that is the Quranic example. So likewise, in our current situation, banning alcohol, the argument is that it won't work. We firmly believe that it has a great potential to work, but we need to have the correct approach. And what is that approach? The Quranic approach. And that is, we need to work on the hearts and we need to work on the minds of those who are generally worsely affected by the consumption of alcohol. And who are they? They are our underprivileged, they are our poor, and our poor communities. So with these few words of advice and with these few thoughts, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those that take lessons from the many lessons which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided for us. From our particular perspective, in terms of the short advice, we are looking at COVID-19 as an alcohol-free period. And we look at the many benefits that we've experienced in that. And we realize that empirically, we can look to an alcohol-free society and all the benefits that we had during the lockdown in terms of an alcohol-free society, in terms of no drunken driving, in terms of the ICUs being free, and so forth and so forth. We have that empirical evidence in front of us, and this is an opportunity for us to look forward to an alcohol-free South Africa, bi-ibnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us and protect us, and this may this message reach all the four corners of the world. Jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.